2, and looking at the relation between some parts of the Soviet activities during the Carnation Revolution in Portugal. He has been doing research on several subjects related to Polish song and the phonographic industry in Portugal, and he's a member of a range of boards that look at Polish music and different composers. And he is also currently a member of the recent project that we've been hearing about here on musicians in Canada. So, welcome, Hugo, and for being here.
Thank you very much. Edmund already said my paper aims to overview different aspects within the musical practices of Portuguese protest singers in exile, especially in Paris during the 1960s and 70s. So, from the end of the 1950s until the Portuguese Revolution that began on the 25th of April. From the end of the 1950s until the Portuguese Revolution that began on the 25th of April 1974, the resistance to the Portuguese dictatorial regime of Estado Novo became increasingly intense and took different forms, necessarily involving several artistic and musical expressions. This was a particularly significant period regarding the increase of authoritarianism and repressive measures by the state, which resulted in the persecution and the political arrests of many members of the opposition to the regime. The beginning of the colonial war in 1961, which over the course of 13 years pitted the regime against the liberation movements of Angola, Mozambique, Guinea, and Cape Verde, had a strong negative impact on the country, both at an economic and social level, leading to the worsening of the effects of an economic crisis which had already forced thousands of Portuguese people to migrate to several European countries and for the USA, many of whom were forced into a role of social subordination and to live in precarious conditions. Furthermore, the war forced military conscription of thousands of young people who were being sent to the war fronts overseas, thus contributing to a growing politicization of various sectors of workers and lower social classes. At the same time, in the universities of Lisbon, Porto and Coimbra, students were becoming increasingly organized in their protest against the regime, demanding improved conditions for the universities, freedom of expression, and an active role in the political decisions. In this context, several artistic expressions, and in particular in music, played a significant role in giving voice and amplifying the contestation and social discontent. At the beginning of the 1960s, musicians such as José Fons and Adriano de Oliveira, both former students at Coimbra University, would start a movement of protest singers that developed throughout the 1960s and 70s, influencing the musical practices of several young people and students from the country's main urban areas. This movement would be responsible for an extensive repertoire, generally in the form of ballads and songs, whose lyrics criticize the regime in a veiled way, using metaphors alluding to the repressive policies, to the poor living conditions, and to the social impact of the colonial war. In fact, the colonial war would be the main trigger of social discontent, generating both dissatisfaction within the military forces, as well as the mass escape of thousands of Portuguese men and women into exile, especially to France, which was a prime fleeing location for those who fought the regime's repression and for young people who refused to participate in the war. According to the historian Vitor Pereira, between 1957 and 1974, around 900,000 Portuguese went to France. So this context led to the development of several associative networks of Portuguese immigrants, which became favorable spaces for awareness-raising activities by various activists and political organizations opposed to the regime, in particular the Portuguese Communist Party, and, as you can see, the many organizations of the radical left that proliferated in France. Created in the wake of the internal conflicts within the Communist Party following the Sino-Soviet conflict, these organizations rejected the party's pro-Soviet alliance and diverged from the party's model of fighting the regime, which was based on the policy of anti-fascist national unity. The radical approach of these organizations called for a vigorous confrontation against the regime, many of which promoted armed struggle and violent insurrection as the main instrument imbued in the radical left-wing movements that appeared all over Europe, and which had one of the greatest exponents of this expression in France precisely during the May of 1968 riots, these organizations would have special impact mostly on street circles and intellectual media. Thus, the activity of Portuguese musicians in exile would manifest itself in a significantly different way from that of protest singers in Portugal, largely derived from these musicians' contacts with the cultural and political realities existing in France, and to their own connections to the different opposition political organizations, as well as to the possibility they had of creating an explicit repertoire directly denouncing the dictatorship and the colonial war. Among these musicians, Luis Chile, who was a member of the Communist Party, settled as a political exile in Paris in 1964 after refusing to fulfill mandatory military service, working different jobs as a night guard, translator, among others. While still in Portugal, he was encouraged by Daniel Felipe, the Cape Verdean poet and student, who we met at the Casa dos Estudantes de Imperio, the House of the Empire Students in Lisbon, where he used to perform regularly in order to set the music for poems written by several Portuguese and African poets, and to compose songs strongly influenced by the interpretative styles of French musicians. In France, Celia started performing mainly in recitals and gatherings organized by Portuguese immigrant associations, which usually had members that were militants of the Communist Party, including the Association of Originaries of Portugal and the Union of Portuguese Students in France. He also began to participate in music and poetry sessions with a more evident political character, many of which, together with several French and Spanish musicians with whom he established friendship, such as Colette Magny, Michel Puig, Georges Brassens, and Paco Ibáñez, among others. It was precisely from his proximity to these musicians that Celia began recording his songs, since it was the French singer Colette Magny who put him in contact with, some French record publishers. So in 1964, he recorded an album published through the label Le Chant du Monde, a French label that was linked to the Portuguese, to the French Communist Party, and was known for publishing a repertoire of traditional and political music of protest singers from different countries. His first album, entitled Portugal and All the Chant du Monde, Songs of Fight, was mainly constituted of songs based on the poetry of several poets associated with the resistance to the Portuguese dictatorship, such as Daniel Felipe, Jean Gaia, Manuel Alegre, José Gomes Ferreira, among others. Being free from the action of the Portuguese censorship, this album would be the first recorded by a Portuguese musician with songs of direct criticism and unequivocal denunciation of the Portuguese dictatorship and the colonial war, with songs which, in Celia's own words, could be characterized by their profoundly anti-colonialist and patriotic content. Among others, the song The Ball, that Manuel already mentioned, is a clear example of denouncing the war crimes committed in the colonial war by Portuguese soldiers against the African liberation movement. Which is an expression that was used to describe described the practice of crossing the Portuguese border clandestinely. This is a movie by the French director Christian de Chalonge, which was precisely focused on the clandestine Portuguese immigration to France. In 1965, he recorded the record Portugal Resiste, which was published by another French political record publisher, the Set du Disque Socialiste, whose introductory text calls for the denunciation of the Portuguese fascist regime and highlights the importance of the uses of poetry as a weapon of struggle and resistance. Although Luis Chilia's phonographic distribution was very limited in Portugal, as his records were being banned by the regime authorities, nonetheless, Chilia became one of the most active singers in denouncing the Portuguese dictatorship at an international level. Until 1974, he was frequently requested to perform for the French progressive public and in international political song music festivals, such as in the German Democratic Republic, or in Cuba, where he participated in 1967 in the first meeting of Protestant, which was organized by the Casa de las Américas, and which was attended by musicians and protest singers from all over the world. With this status and international recognition, he was contacted in 1967 by Jacques Zentunge, which was a clandestine employee of the Communist Party in France, to compose a song with the purpose of being broadcast on the radio Portugal Live, Portugal Free, which was broadcasted from Bucharest in Romania. He then wrote the lyrics and the music for the song Avant Camarada, Avant Comrade, which would later be recorded in the Soviet Union by the Portuguese singer Luisa Bastos, also a member of the Communist Party, and which would become one of the most popular themes of the anti-fascist resistance associated with the Communist Party, still used today as one of the party's anthems. Nonetheless, many of Chilia's songs could be characterized by its simple melodic contours and the harmonic accompaniment on the acoustic guitar, usually sung in a low register, enhancing the melancholy and gloom expressed in the lyrics, and thus highlighting the literary content of the poems. On the other hand, José Mário Tempo, who was another Portuguese musician exiled in Paris since 1963, and whose musical and political activity my colleague Ricardo Andrade will talk in more depth in a few moments, he was more focused in exploring the musical dimension of protest songs and looking for ways to amplify the communicative effectiveness of the messages conveyed in the lyrics. As a former member of the Communist Party, and having participated in the formation of some of the first Marxist-Leninist organizations in France, he would consolidate his musical activity during the turmoil of the May 1968. From the perspective that music can be used as a weapon against the regime, José Mário Branco created several songs that addressed sensitive problems among the Portuguese community in France, namely the immigration, exile, and the colonial war. The influence of French musicians who had published records in authors' editions prompted José Mário Branco to invest in the self-managed production of a phonogram with songs that explicitly denounced the hardships of the colonial war. In this single, which included two songs, Ronda de Soldadinho, which can be translated as the Round of the Little Soldier, and Mãos ao Ar, Hands Up, he intended to distribute it in the same way as the clandestine books and political leaflets, that is, by setting up a pre-purchase system which eventually allowed him to finance the recording, the manufacturing, and the distribution of the record outside the commercial circuits. Besides France, this single would circulate both in Portugal, where several copies entered clandestinely inside the white sleeve, and abroad with the help of several political organizations, such as the Portuguese National Liberation Patriotic Front, settled in Algiers, where the song Round of the Little Soldier was broadcasted to the radio Voz da Liberdade, Radio Voice of Freedom. This song, inspired by children's rhymes, explicitly denounced the political situation in Portugal and the illegitimacy of the colonial occupation, addressing the journey of thousands of deserters who fled to France, as the song states, so they do not go and kill in the war. And I'll play a small part of the song. Thank you. after the May of 1968, Flores became involved in the Marxist-Leninist organizations that were swarming among the Portuguese community, and he had a strong commitment to the culture and the political action. Groups such as the Communist, the OCMLP, which can be translated as the Portuguese Communist Marxist-Leninist Organization, and the Portuguese League of Education and Popular Culture. All of the Tino Flores' musical production in exile became associated with his militant role in these organizations. In this context, he would compose several songs that were intended to function, in his own words, as pamphleteering instruments in the fight against fascism and the colonial war. This was particularly evident in the phonograms he recorded during this period, which were three self-published records entitled Long Live the Revolution, Organize the People Are Invincible, and The People in Arms Will Crush the Bourgeoisie, that were usually disseminated and sold to the publications of these organizations or other political events. A small part of this song. This is one of the songs included in his second record, Organize the People Are Invincible. Space for the ideological education of communism, which was in tune with the discourses of the Maoist radical left. His musical activity was an extension of other artistic expressions, particularly theater, as he would be involved in the so-called Grupos de Teatro Operário, workers' theater groups, that were used by these political organizations as a strategic way of raising awareness among the immigrant communities and making visible the forms of political struggle and action that were being developed. This perspective led Flores to distance himself from other musicians and vocal singers by seeking a musical style based on the stylistic forms of Portuguese traditional musical expressions, through which he sought forms of representation of what he understood to be more vigorous and more easily identified in the struggles of the people. The different perceptions regarding the articulation of expressions of popular culture with the anti-fascist struggle emerged particularly in the context of exile, contributing to the discussion distance between the different political groups. These divergences reflected the way some musicians and their musical activity were perceived, as happened during the session entitled La Chanson de Combat Portuguese, the Portuguese song of struggle, held at the Theatre de la Naturalité in Paris in 1970, which featured the participation of José Afonso, who was coming from Portugal, José Mário Branco, Silva, Tino Flores, among others. This concert intended to be a key moment to illustrate the potential of the uses of music as a way of denouncing the Portuguese political situation in Europe, and represented, from the perspective of these musicians, an important moment in the relationship between this group of singers. However, at the entrance of the session, a leaflet signed by a group called the Comité Long Live the Revolution of the Proletariat and the Comité José Covinto da Cruz, which I cannot translate, was circulated, which included an open letter to José Afonso entitled Cry, Comrade, Cry, in a pejorative allusion to his song Canta Camarada Canta, Sing, Comrade, Sing. It also included a review of the record Long Live the Revolution by Tino Flores. So in this open letter, José Afonso is accused by this group of contributing to a certain anesthesia of the political left struggle, as his songs would represent the absence of an authentic revolutionary essence and which were described as petite bourgeois folklore. And in a detailed analysis to the lyrics of his first record, Tino Flores is accused of referring too frequently to the misfortune of the soldiers who participated in the war, instead of referring to the achievements and merits of the African liberation movement. So this group considered that Tino Flores' songs did not offer any type of proposal or appeal to combat the imperialism and the colonialism. This episode ends up illustrating the tensions and political ideological discussions about the role of art and culture within Marxist-Leninist political organizations. For José Afonso, who was not exiled, he was coming from Portugal, this was representative of the environment existing among the cultural and recreative associations of the Portuguese immigrants in France, which he considered to be dominated by sectarianism emanating from the division of the political left. To quote him, he says, "In Paris, the political groups were formed whose field of recruitment and action were these associations. In many of them, I sang and I often spoke with some failures. There were many disputes and sometimes interference that almost sounded like provocations." So, in a way of conclusion, despite the political and aesthetic divisions mentioned here, which motivated different conceptions regarding the articulation between expressions of popular culture and the anti-fascist struggle, it is important to note that within the scope of the political and cultural realities among the associative milieu of Portuguese immigrant communities, as well as within the activity of distant political groups opposing the regime in exile, this environment was aesthetic in the configuration not only of an extensive repertoire of performed and recorded protest music in France, but also for the universal popular music that was produced in Portugal since then. This would be particularly significant for the aesthetic